Anyway, without wasting any more wibbly wobbly timey wimey stuff, let me introduce the man himself. Put your plungers together, please, and welcome the voice of the Daleks and also the Cybermen, Mr. Nicholas Briggs.
Greetings, fellow Daleks.
Hello. Can you position me on this chair?
Hold on a sec. Let me come round here. Let me have a look at this. This requires some precise engineering. Yeah. Come forward slightly. A little bit more forward.
Yep.
There you go. Is that, right. I think it looks about right to me.
Does that look okay?
Yeah, that'll do. So, greetings, Mr. Nick Briggs, or should I say Emperor Briggs. It's an honour for us all to virtually meet you here on Skaro. Thank you for coming. And let me just start off the talk with a very serious question. I see you've put your feet up on the table there, so you're getting very comfortable.
Comfortable.
The question is, are you not a little bit warm and cramped inside that Dalek chassis?
All spaces work for the Emperor.
Well, there's a little air hole at the side. If you need to get some fresh air, just open the flap. It should help. And there's also some pocket fans in there as well that I chucked in for you.
Excellent.
Is that Dalek deodorant? Oh, dear. Right, anyway, serious time. Okay.
Oh, serious.
Now, we all know you as the voice of the Daleks, of course, as you demonstrated already. And the Cyberman, of course. Just give us a little, give a little bit of Cyberman.
Bit of Cyberman? Oh, hold on. A little bit of adjustment needs to be made.
Yeah, we've got some representatives here.
Delete.
Awesome.
Is that all right?
Yeah, it pleases them greatly. But we've also got quite a few other things on your CV. You're an actor, you're a composer, director, presenter, producer, sound designer and writer. I mean, you must be exhausted.
Well, I think that's fairly accurate. I am exhausted. I always say when people make a list like that, I always say there's literally no beginning to my talent.
That's it. Well, the real question then is, before you become professionally involved with, obviously, Doctor Who, which we know you for, what is your earliest recollection or memory of being captivated by sci-fi or even Doctor Who? Because I remember personally, my first memory, it was the movie with Peter Cushing. That was my first exposure to Doctor Who. I didn't start in the usual way. So how did it start for you?
Yeah, well, the thing is, I always say it's very difficult for me to actually work that out because I remember watching Power of the Daleks and, already knowing about the Daleks. So I must have seen an earlier Doctor Who episode, but I don't have any precise memories of, say, the Daleks' master plan, for example. But I do remember seeing the Celestial Toy Room story. I have distinct memories of that. And I certainly remember the 10th Planet because I remember going around with a little wooden stool we had in our house, and I remember putting it up my jumper to be a chest unit, and taking one of those tiny little mouth organs, you know, and because I thought the Cybermen sounded all sort of sing-songy, and I remember going around talking through that, saying that was a Cyberman's voice. So that was. But as to exactly when I started watching Doctor Who or my earliest, I don't remember. I feel like it was sort of hardwired into me. It must have happened at some point because, you know, you don't really remember anything from before you were 4 years old. You know, I think you have the odd flash of memory from times like that, don't you? But most of our memories from those early years are memories that have been implanted by other people who've said to us, oh, I remember when you were a toddler, you used to do this. And when people tell you that kind of stuff, you have that image in your head and then you think you've remembered it. Mm. So I couldn't say, but certainly it really is. You know, I am that sad. It really is. It's been in my mind since as long as I can remember, really.
Well, that's good. So it sounds to me like you were sort of just born. You were just born with it then,
yes,
really.
That's right. Yes.
That's a good answer.
In a Dalek incubation tank.
Yeah, I mean, I wonder when what your first words were. Were your first words exterminate?
Inevitably.
there must have been.
Well, that's an interesting thing. That's an interesting thing, the whole business about the word exterminate for Daleks, because they didn't really start chanting exterminate until the 70s, did they? There wasn't really that thing. You know, it was the newspapers.
Well, that's right. They had a lot of other catchphrases.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Daleks conquer and destroy, particularly.
Yeah, it wasn't quite as catchy, though, was it?
No. But you know what I mean? All that kind of exterminate, exterminate, exterminate before they killed people, that basically started in the 70s. And I think it's as a result of all the media coverage that always used to say, the Daleks, exterminate, exterminate. It was almost the media who coined, you know, the news media who coined that catchphrase. And then Terry Nation, returning to writing it, you know, adopted that because... I don't think he went back and researched. I think he thought, yeah, I know all about this, and just, you know, did what he remembered.
Well, it's difficult, isn't it, when people come in to, I guess, the side of production and are taking on a legacy of someone else's work and they're trying to continue it forwards, you know. And obviously, you know that well, because that's what you have done, really, with bringing in your own spin on how the Daleks should sound and how they should have, you know, their different personalities and whatnot. That's something that you've had to, I guess, look back on and try and look at what people have done before you. So when it came to bringing the series back in 2005, what was your process in terms of trying to create a new take on Daleks, if you like?
Well, you know, I'd been having some practice at Big Finish because I started doing the Dalek voice for Big Finish in about the year 2000. And we'd been through various phases of trying to work out how to best do a Dalek voice. We used various kinds of ring modulators. And then I had just, I think it was for a story called Jubilee, which was sort of vaguely adapted to be Dalek, the first new series TV one, that, you know, I'd bought this thing called the Moogafuga.
Yes.
Moog ring modulator. Which I don't know how I heard about it. I think I might have seen it in a shop window and decided to try it out. And that really created the sound that I'd been looking for years. So that was the sound that Russell T. Davis had heard, because he'd been whether a subscriber or a regular buyer of Big Finish, one of the two. Or both,
yes.
You know, and he just said, well, we just want this guy to do the Dalek voice because, you know, he's written a very sad article in Doctor Who magazine where he talks about how to do it. So he, not only can he do it, he can also do the technical side, which I'm sure you've all heard me say this. So then, you know, I brought it along to the read through and did the voice in a very typical traditional Dalek way. And it was shortly before the filming that Russell got in touch with me and by phone and said, you know, OK, look, we know you can do the typical Dalek voice, but I'd love you to push the envelope a bit. You know, the sound is there and everything, but, you know, you can, don't be frightened to make it more emotional, he said. And, you know, and he said,
could you show us what you sort of had? Because this is quite potentially something that nobody has really heard then. What was that original sound before you were told to, you know, spice it up? What would that sound like?
Well, no, I mean, it was just that, you know, just
original way of speaking like this all the time,
you know. Whereas you notice when Christopher Eccleston's in there with the Dalek and I do all that kind of, you will be exterminated, and it's got more of a sort of broader, you know. So what I said afterwards was, I said, you know, if you think of the whole percentage of voice expression as 100%, I said, I think the Daleks were about at 10%. And then I said, I immodestly feel that I pushed it to 30%. So just to make it more, I think they had a sudden crisis of confidence where they thought, my goodness, if people watch this and there's just this speak your weight machine talking for, you know, 25% of on-screen time, people are just going to switch off. I think they were, they never said that to me. That's just my own, you know, modest.
And yet
inference.
They were so wrong, because that's, you know, what a lot of people tune in for is well, that, of course.
The brilliant thing about the Dalek voice is that it's so imitatable, isn't it? You know, because it's so unreasonable and unfeeling, and it's really easy for people to attribute it to anyone they don't like. I mean, you know, the TV writer Dennis Potter attributed it to one of the BBC executives. He said he sounds like a croak voiced Dalek, you know. And I had beautiful moment when shortly after doing it, the first one, I think, there was a Dalek prom at the Albert Hall. Well, no, it wasn't a Dalek prom. I'm getting carried away here. There was the Proms.
Well,
and they had
you're giving us ideas now for future events.
And they'd asked me to go and do the Dalek voice for when the orchestra were playing and all that stuff. There was going to be a Dalek there. And so we had a day rehearsing. And I can tell you a little bit about that in a minute. But when I turned up for the performance the next day, it never occurred to me. I just thought, I'm just going in for another day's work here. And as I approached, if you've been to the Albert Hall, as you go up the steps, there's a long approach to it. And as I got closer, I could see that there were hundreds of people all ringed around it, queuing up to go in. And as I was approaching, I could hear little voices going, exterminate, exterminate. And as I got closer, I realised there were kids walking around doing the Dalek action. And I remember a kid, as I was walking past, of course, he would have had no idea that I was about to go in there and do the Dalek voice. And he was saying, you will be exterminated. You will always be exterminated, he said. And I thought, my goodness. That was the first inkling I'd got that it. I thought Dalek mania is going to happen again. You know, all the worries they had about them being outmoded, because they had all sorts of potential ideas when the Daleks came back, of doing them only CGI, of changing the look of them quite radically, and of having them speaking in a different way. I mean, the casting director of Doctor Who, whose name I can't remember, he said to me, it was quite good that we eventually decided to go with your kind of Dalek voice, because we were thinking about maybe other treatments, like it would just have a very calm voice. You know, you just thought, wow.
A calm voice. You will be exterminated now.
You
I don't know that would work.
Be exterminated.
You Dalek of tranquility comes to mind.
Please, can I exterminate you? Please?
Yeah, thank God that,
if that's all right
common
by
sense
you?
Prevailed on that one.
Yes. Yeah. Well, yeah, it was obviously. Russell T. Davis who was the one who was saying, you know, don't change the theme tune, don't change the police box, and let's have the Daleks look and sound like Daleks. Let's not mess with what we know works. But, you know, when you go into any artistic endeavour, there will always be people who say, hey, can we just maybe change everything? Can the Doctor come from the planet Banana? And, you know, and what?
You find out with the franchises all franchises have this moment where they try and change things up or mix up the formula. Yeah. But obviously back when we're talking about when, you know, it was the new era of Doctor Who for a new generation, if you like, I think that I think everyone here would agree that obviously the way it was handled and the personalities and the voices that you put into it were bang on. I mean, it's ignited that
thank you
passion in the franchise again for a whole new generation. And I'm sure a lot of people in the audience here probably came into it from seeing your iteration of the Dalek, you know, which is testament to it. But what I wanted to
see the Cyberman nodding
slightly,
there.
Of course. Well, they're very agreeable, these Cybermen, apparently. I want to rewind a little bit. The interest that you had, obviously, in sci-fi and Doctor Who and all that, that you've had since you were born.
Yeah.
I want to understand, how did you turn that into a day job? How did you go from, oh, I really like Doctor Who, to suddenly working within the industry and having that as a day job?
Well, firstly, it's not suddenly. And secondly, it's luck. You know, it really is luck. The thing about luck is that it's totally random and it's to do with coincidence. Mm. So who would have thought, you know, you imagine drawing a timeline of Russell T. Davis's life, because he is the important figure in the transformation of my life, as it were. There he is at BBC Wales producing, what was it called? Why Don't You? And all that kind of thing. And one day he wanted to write stuff, so he managed to amass enough money to take time off and write something. And, you know, he's beavering away doing that. I'm fiddling around. What am I doing at that point? Am I doing Big Finish at that point? I'm not sure. Maybe I'm doing stuff, you know, BBV videos, pursuing, you know, the mad dream of trying to be creative, having a huge dose of imposter syndrome, feeling that I can't, that I'm not the kind of person who deserves to be, to deserves to follow my dream. You know, I don't come from a family of actors or creative people. You know, my parents were very working class. You know what I mean? It was a difficult decision to go to drama school, all that kind of stuff. You know, if any of you think I sound vaguely posh, this is entirely a construct of drama school. I went to drama school during a time where they still got rid of your accent. You know, they don't do that now. They say, this is the way you speak. This is important. Let's learn this other accent called RP, received pronunciation, you know. And so by rights, I should have a Hampshire accent. I should have quite a rural accent, you know. That's the way I was brought up. But, you know, anyway, you see these two people on completely different courses. And then finally, just by virtue of the fact that Russell gets very popular doing Queer as Folk, and then eventually the BBC keep asking him to do things. And every time they ask him to do something, what would you like to do? He goes, Doctor Who. And they go, yeah, anyway. But eventually he says he wants to do Doctor Who. And someone, I think it's Lorraine Heggersey, listens to him and goes, you want to do Doctor Who? Actually, let's do Doctor Who. That happens. Meanwhile, he's a Doctor Who fan. He's listening to Big Finish. I'm poodling away in my slightly pointless life. And then our paths intersect because he's heard Big Finish and he's read an article about me being able to do, you know. And then that's how that happens. And it's about who you know. It's who you bump into. You know, I was friends with Doctor Who fans in Southampton who became friends with Doctor Who fans in the London area, and they started doing a thing called audio visuals, you know, Doctor Who audio plays for fun. And I got involved with that because I wasn't getting any work as an actor and spent many years when I should have been...
Before the precursor to Big Finish, was it?
Yes, that's right. That's right. Yeah. So it's all coincidence and luck, really. I mean, of course, I've been determined and of course, I've tried really hard. But there are loads of people out there who are determined, talented, try really hard and never get anywhere. So it's just luck that, you know, I kept sort of hitting the doors and one of them opened. And, you know, that's how it happened.
You have to have that resilience, obviously, but a bit of luck helps as well. But obviously, what you haven't said is the part about the talent, of course. I think you're being a bit modest.
Well, you're very kind.
That's required as well. And, you know, it's something that a few people want to get into. I know that on the panel here, obviously, Scarlett is very much interested in that side of thing as well and getting into the industry. I mean, do you have any questions, Scarlett, for Nick on that side of things?
Oh, well, Nick just gave me some nasty flashbacks to the RP tone of voice that is practically drilled into us. Yes. So thanks for that. But of course, there's naturally different ways of getting into the industry. There's the classic way of going through your education, getting an agent, so on and so forth. I'm assuming you've done all this, I'm guessing.
Well, I went to drama school, yes.
And how did you start? We can get into your voice acting a bit later, but your normal acting, you did look for work naturally. If you could explain maybe a bit of your process as you were an actor and how you went looking about work for that and how you did with that side of things.
Sure. That's very difficult.
It's really difficult. And it's not a very good answer. I was no good at it and am still no good at it. I can't recall ever having got a job from an audition. And I've done lots of auditions in my time, nowhere near as many as a lot of people I know do loads of auditions all the time. And I'm just terrible at them. You know, the sense of everything focusing down to that point of importance and stress. It's really difficult. I remember there's an actor, I can't remember his name, he plays the lead in Breaking Bad, which I've never seen, I have to confess. But he said the way he gets through an audition is to think of it that he loves acting and it's something that he'd do for himself on his own if he didn't get paid to do it. And he thinks of it as he's just letting them see something that he likes doing anyway. And that really relaxes him and makes him give a good audition. They always say getting an agent's important. I suppose it is, because the agents have, you know, access to information within the industry about when jobs are coming up. But yes, I mean, I decided after how many years, I can't remember, but I decided eventually, you know, because I had to get a proper job, because I spent all my time doing the audiovisual stuff. But of course, there's only so long you can keep signing on. And that was when Margaret Thatcher was around. Big boo there from everyone. Yeah. And she,
I think some of the people are too young here to know Margaret Thatcher. She was firsthand, luckily.
She was horrible.
If you signed on for too long, she put you in this thing called employment training by her government, I would say. And so I ended up on this weird training scheme. And one good thing came out of it. I already typed very, very fast anyway, just through typing scripts on my typewriter. Yes, a typewriter for years. But I learned to touch type. And got really good high speeds. It's been a huge importance to me in terms of all my writing and Big Finish work, because actually getting stuff down is no problem at all, because I touch type at an incredible speed. So I ended up working for some magazines, just putting things in envelopes and packing up stuff and sending off. And then I remember they gave me the job of typing up the letters because they couldn't be bothered to type them up. So I said, yeah, I'll do that. And then, you know, when half an hour later I said, right, I've done that. They went, what do you mean you can't have done it yet? I said, yeah, I can. I can type really fast. And I went, oh. And they went, okay. I said, and also I've written some answers to some of the letters. Is that all right? And they went, well, no, that's not what we asked you to do.
Too efficient.
Quite good, actually. Yeah, okay. And so bit by bit, they realized that they could just give me a press release from some film company that they couldn't get an interview from. And I would be able to type up the press release and then change it around and turn it into an article, you know. And so I thought, I'm not an actor anymore. I'm going to just be working in magazines. And so during that process...
There's nothing wrong with that, of course, but...
No, not at all.
Luckily for you, it didn't go that way.
It's all part of the same thing. It's all to do with communication. Do you see? Everything I've done has been to do with communication. And during this process, I was still doing the, I don't know whether you've heard of them, the Mythmakers interviews.
Yes, I've seen the one where you walk around with Sylvester McCoy for about an hour.
I used to walk around with a lot of them. And one of the people I walked around with was Colin Baker. And a lot of the actors I've done the interviews with, they said to me things like, oh, you're really good at this. Are you an actor? And I'd say, well, I've kind of given it up. And they go, oh, really? Yeah, I could help you. And none of them ever did, except Colin Baker, who said it to me. And he said, I'll help you. And so I got on with him really well. And I spoke to him and said, well, I phoned him up. I said, well, can you really help me? He went, yeah. Don't worry. You leave it with me. And I thought, there we go. Nothing will happen.
Oh, wow.
Then he phoned me back one day and said, listen, I can get you a job in some weekly rep in Devon for next to no money, doing, you know, being an acting ASM, you know, an assistant stage manager, but also playing parts. So, you know, making props, painting the set and learning loads of lines as well.
That was good of him.
And he put me in touch with the producer, who was an old pirate of the theatre called Charles Vance, who... you know, he got me other work as well. He gave me the best audition I ever had, which was that he brought me in to play a part in a national tour of Brideshead Revisited. And he said, he said, sit down now. I want you to read this. And I was thinking, oh, God. He said, now, before you read it, I want to tell you, you've already got the job, all right? I went, oh, okay.
Well, that takes the pressure off.
And it did. I gave a really good audition. So that was fine.
So I think that's a formality. So,
Yeah. Yeah, but he was doing it because of, he said, you know, Colin Baker's a friend of mine, and he says you're good, and he is a man of honour, and I will take his word, and I will give you a job. And I can tell just looking at you, he said, that you will be brilliant, which is, of course, nonsense. How on earth could he tell? Luckily, he was right, of course. So I got I got into theatre and did a few theatre jobs, and so, but even that dried up for a while, and I ended up being, I went and worked for the Sci-fi channel, and did ended up being a press and PR manager there. But that was because of someone I knew there who desperately needed an assistant. And he said, I need you to come in and work full time here. I said, I can't do that because I need to get acting work. And he said, oh, well, I can't offer you the job. And I said, OK. And then a few weeks later, he got back to me and said, I'm so desperate. Just come in on any terms you like. You know, I need an intelligent person here. So I ended up spending all my time filing, you know, slides of Star Trek and God knows what, and writing press releases. Yeah. And then the big finish thing came up.
It got you in the door.
Yeah, exactly. So I could have gone off and done that, but it's through people I knew through all of that that, eventually after doing the audiovisual stuff for so long, Gary Russel, who I was eventually doing that with, you know, said to me, wouldn't it be brilliant if one day we got a license to do this properly with the BBC? And because of Jason Hay-Gellery and his business acumen and the money he could put behind it, we eventually, to cut a very long story short that many of you have probably already heard, you know, got into that. And then, you know, other actors I knew put me in touch with other producers. So I was doing a regular theatre job in Nottingham every year at the Theatre Royal, doing a thriller season there. But now Big Finish has almost completely consumed my life, because I think it's in 2006 I became co-executive producer and subsequently creative director. And really, you know, that's it. You know, I'm reading scripts, storylines, having meetings about marketing, writing scripts, doing sound design, doing music. It just, you know, there is more work than there are hours in the day for me to do. That's a very long answer. Like, that's my whole life right there.
Yeah. Quite literally in every field in the acting.
Yeah, but you know, my answer to your question is it is tough, it's difficult. And when I speak to actors in the green room at Big Finish, a recording, although I haven't done that for a while because we're recording remotely now because of COVID-19, you know, my heart goes out to them where they're always talking about, you know, I did this casting the other day, and you know, and it's terrible. I mean, I've been for castings for adverts and they've gone, and now, if you could, and I go, what? Let's just take your trousers down. What? You know, it was some advert for a chocolate biscuit where someone loved the chocolate biscuit so much that they left their house. It was a German advert, and this is apparently hilarious. They left the house forgetting to put their trousers on because they're so interested in the chocolate biscuit. And for the for the advert, you know, I would have had, I didn't get the job, but there was this awful humiliating moment where they just went, so they just wanted to see what I looked like in my underpants.
Oh God!
I'm sure
that's a terrible, terrible audition experience.
You gotta do what you gotta do, Ren.
I think thank God I put a good pair on that day.
There's no advert. Take off your clothes.
And where can we find the advert, Nick? Just if we want to look this up and broadcast it on the stream.
The tragedy is I didn't get the job.
After all that, that's a real kick in the nuts. I want to just ask a question, just to do with, you know, your process when you're about to do a recording. You know, it might be for Big Finish or it might be for the BBC, and maybe the process is different depending on which one you're going to do. But if you're about to become a Dalek, do you need to get psyched up for it? Do you need to get yourself in the zone? Is there something you do? You know, you get very angry, do you, or is it just you coming out?
Definitely. Playing a Dalek is no different to playing any other part. You just have to think of what it is the Dalek wants and how it's going to go about it. So I've never been a particularly method actor, depending on the kind of part I'm playing, I suppose. I mean, so yeah, you do. So I have shortcuts to get into the right frame of mind. I mean, when I do Big Finish, I'm usually alone in a booth, and sometimes This is the first time I've confessed this ever. Sometimes I do the classic thing that kids do in the playground, and I stick my arms out in front of me and I move my head around in that mechanical way, you know? And I often do exclusive lines like that.
Oh, exclusive right here, folks.
Yes.
That is exclusive.
Yeah.
And, you know, you've done a lot of different.
That's not so easy to do on the TV series. You know, on the TV series, quite often, you know, I'm on set, and the filming's usually taking place in a set which is, you know, I don't know, 10 or 15 meters away from me, and it's quite often quite enclosed, so I can't actually see the other actors, but I can see them on a monitor in front of me. And there I am sitting there by the monitor, usually by the sound man who set me up with my ring modulator and everything connected to his mixer. And I've got my cans on and I can hear the acting going on. Now, of course, when they shout action, everyone sitting around near me goes quiet. But what you've got is all the makeup and costume people, who I'm often quite chatty with, the director, the continuity person, sometimes visiting producers coming to just see everything's okay, and sometimes friends of producers, and sometimes families who've had the, you know, families of members of the production crew or cast who are visiting. Usually there's quite a lot of extra people, all the lighting people, all the sparks people around. They're all standing around there, and they're all technicians, part of the crew working on the show. And the actors are on the set in a make-believe world, of course, doing their thing. And here I am sitting amongst them all, and a lot of them...
in the closet.
I'm just on my own sitting with them. And a lot of them won't know who I am or what my job is, right? And so suddenly, during the filming of a scene, I stand up and start screaming into a microphone. And the number of times I've had people look at me like, what? Is someone going to stop this guy? You know?
Yeah.
He's gone crazy.
Can they hear the process sound or just you shouting away?
They can just hear me shouting away. I mean, the continuity person can hear in her cans, the director can hear in their cans, and the people on set, there's a speaker. So they can sort of hear in the distance a distant Dalek voice going on the set. But it takes them by surprise. So it takes some guts, really, to stand up in front of a lot. You know, you can't go round to the 50 or so people there and go, excuse me, I'm about to do some shouting. I don't want you to think I've gone bonkers. I'm actually in this program and I'm doing a voice. Because it is a very unusual thing for a voice performer to be there during filming. And I know a number of first assistant directors I've worked with have had that. They've looked at me and said, why are you here? Doesn't this just get dubbed later? And it's only a sort of weird hangover from the old series, which is how they used to do it in Television Centre or wherever, where the Dalek voice people were there, you know. And there's an added bonus now, because the lights on the Dalek are, as they are now as I'm talking, activated by my voice. So you don't get the problem from the old series where allegedly the Dalek operators learnt the lines to flash the lights in time.
But oh, no.
If they did learn the lines, I don't know. I mean, I was just watching Planet of the Daleks the other day, and you're lucky if the Dalek lights flash at all.
Someone's not paying attention on that one. Oh, that's funny. So, but what about when you've got multiple Daleks on the set? Like, for example... Yeah. You know, the Witch's Familiar episode that the room up there is based on. There's loads in there, and they're all talking sort of nearly all at once. That's all done real time.
That's right. I mean, and when they're all chanting together, what I do on each different take, I will do a different Dalek voice, so they have multiple ones to layer up afterwards. Said, you know, on a scene like that, I would do a lot of ADR, you know, additional dialogue recording or whatever ADR stands for this week, post-syncing, you know, everyone has a different idea of exactly what it sounds like, and they're all absolutely sure that they're right. I just don't know. But yeah.
We'll just agree on what you've gone with there. That works for me.
But when the Daleks are talking... No, I just do it with my voice. No. I just do it, I never. It's just a high, low, middle, you know, whatever, various different voices. And the pressure on set for the TV series is to change them instantaneously myself, whereas when I'm doing it on audio, I can afford to take a breath. And I know that it'll be edited out. But, you know, I can't wait for Peter Capaldi or Jodie Whittaker or whoever to wait for me to change my Dalek voice. You know, I have to just get on with it and provide them with the lines they need to hear in order to get on with the scene, you know.
You know, now you've said this, you're gonna have to give us a quick demo here of about 10 different Daleks here.
I'm not going to do 10.
Sorry, 50. 50.
Instigate maximum security. I obey. All Daleks proceed to control points.
It's that sort of thing, isn't it?
Oh, brilliant.
There was three, all right?
The Daleks. That will do. That's great.
There was a particular scene in, I think, what's it called? The one where David Tennant nearly regenerates. Is it called Journey's End? Stolen Earth.
Yeah.
In that Stolen one, there's a bit when you first reveal the Daleks and they're all in the control room going around and talking to each other. And Graham Harper had done this really clever single shot where he was catching one Dalek and then one moved past and he tracked the other way. And, you know, it was like, right, all these Daleks are all talking. I thought, right, this is me doing it really quickly then. Okay. And he was telling me, you know, and that one starts speaking just as the camera moves that way. So I'm watching the screen and looking at my lines. Luckily, by two takes, I've learned them. So I'm straight in there with the lines, you know. So it's quite, you know, you work for your money, basically. You earn the money.
Well, there's an episode where the Cybermen and the Daleks are having a face-off.
Oh, yes.
I mean, you've got to surely change the dials on that one because that's a tricky
one. That was an interesting one because at that point, I think when I did the Pandorica one, by then I'd sussed that really I needed two ring modulators, one set up as a Cyberman and one set up as a Dalek. And I had
a
fader in front of me and I would just fade from one to the other. But when I did that particular episode, I can never remember the names of those ones because when I received the scripts, they just had episode numbers on them. I'm a massive Doctor Who fan. And I should remember. What was it called?
Doomsday.
Doomsday. Thank you.
Well done, Stubby.
I have to say,
I used to read that several times.
when I was doing that, I had to sort of, I got them to get the microphone set up on a high thing right in front of me. So, because they were having me just hold a mic, but I got them to set it up on a stand in front of me so that I had my arms free so I could keep twisting the ring modulator settings. But I eventually said, I think it was Graham Harper, wasn't it? Directed. Yeah. I said, was it Graham? Was it Graham Harper, that one it was, wasn't it?
Oh, that's some not so knowledge there that I don't have. Stabby?
I don't
Stabby,
know, do you know it, sadly.
Yeah, it was Graham Harper. It was Graham Harper. Sorry, I was just getting confused. Old and confused. I said to him, who's in this shot? And he'd say, oh, well, this is a shot of the Cybermen, right? I said, well, shall I do the voice of whichever monster is in the shot? And just one of the floor assistants or third ADs can read in the lines of the other creature. So I remember, I can't remember the young lady's name, but she was absolutely thrilled at being a Cyberman at one point. She said, I get to be the Cyberman. So she read in the Cyberman lines while I was doing the Dalek lines. But of course, the standoff, if you remember, took place. Yeah. There were two different locations viewing it on a screen.
That's right.
The Doctor and Jackie viewing it on a screen in in that sort of the Cyberman place, and in the Dalek place, they were viewing it on the screen. And then there was the actual confrontation taking place in the corridor. So I filmed that scene three times and did the voices three times. And who knows which takes they used for which bits, but they did use takes from the studio. I didn't have to revoice those bits. And that's the problem. You see, when you're acting physically in front of a camera, using your own body and face, you pretty much know that the important take is when they come in for your close-up. That's not to say that you don't act on the other takes, but you know, you save yourself for the close-up. You know, you're doing the wide shots and the different shots of other people, and you're giving the performance, but you're not, you know, you're not giving absolutely 110%, as it were. And then when they come round for your close-up, you know that when they when the audience hear and see you, it will all, even if they cut to someone else doing it, they'll be taking it all from this angle. Whereas with the Daleks,
yes,
they'll just take whichever bit of voice was happening on whichever shot they're using. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
So I have to, I have to be hyped up to give the 110% performance as if in close up on every single angle.
Yeah, on every single one.
Because I know from bitter experience, not that anyone will notice, because I'm just, you know, being ridiculously perfectionist about it. But I know from bitter experience that on the one time when I don't give it 100%, that will be the take they use. You know, because to the untrained ear, a Dalek is a Dalek is a Dalek, and as long as it's shouting and saying exterminate, they don't really mind if it's going exterminate or exterminate. You know, to some people, it will just sound the same. You know what I mean? But to us, of course,
is that quite hard to maintain? Or
well,
you must go through throat sweets a lot.
Well, funnily enough, I've never really had throat troubles with the Daleks. It's just the Judoon.
Because you talk like that.
And people always say to me when I do the Judoon, does that hurt your throat? And I go,
yes.
You know, so.
Oh, no.
But the only time I had throat trouble with the Daleks was during Into the Dalek, when they kept releasing all this noxious green smoke when we were inside the Dalek, and I could feel it getting to my throat.
Ew.
And then we got
on the set. Oh, right.
On the set. Yeah. Yeah. And not in my hotel room. And then it depends what you're into, I suppose. I could feel my voice getting worse and worse. And then by, I think, the final day I was on set for that, I couldn't speak. I had, to all intents and purposes, completely lost my voice. And so they said, well, we'll capture the rest in ADR. There was 2 years running that whatever smoke they were releasing gave me really bad throat and then chest infections. And there was one point where
it wasn't just dry ice. It must have been something else.
It wasn't that. No, it was something else. It was like a smoke candle kind of thing. And they always say these things have been tested. But you think, well, but how many years have they tested them for?
Well, they mean tested on you. That's what they mean.
I'm the guinea pig. Yeah. There were 2 years, right? The medical guy on set, Glyn, said to me after a while, because he could hear me coughing and stuff. I literally can't remember which production this was on, but he said, I've got a stethoscope. I'd just like to listen to your chest. He said, so can you go to your little third of a caravan thing that we stayed in the trailers, you know? So I went in there, and then he just got out and listened. He said, breathe and cough and listen to the back of my back as well. And went, I'm going to make an appointment for you with the doctor we use. Okay, fine. So I went to see this.
Not the doctor.
Not that.
Did you say doctor?
Calm down, you two.
Did you say doctor?
Yeah. So I went to this doctor's. It sounds like a classic joke, this. I went to the doctor's. And she had a listen to my chest. And I won't say it in public what she said, but it was several rude words. It was like, conveyed the feeling, the sense of, oh, my God.
Yeah, I might not want to be breathing that stuff in anymore. Oh, dear.
So she just said, she gave me the strongest antibiotics known to man. She said, now, these are going to knock you right down. So I'm going to give you some steroids as well to bring you back up. I said, OK, right, fine. Is this all right? And the next day on set, my good friend Barnaby Edwards, who's, you know, the chief Dalek operator, along with Nicholas Pegg, he actually went and had a word with the medical guy, because he said, you know, as you will have witnessed here, he said, Nick normally talks a lot, but last night in the bar, he was like, insane, you know, he was speaking three times as fast as normal, and it was the steroids they put, and that's what it's the steroids.
I wonder what a Dalek on steroids would sound like. Maybe that would be an interesting episode idea.
You will be exterminated.
I think that's how I was speaking.
Asylum of the Daleks too, that's what we need now.
Oh, dear. Well, you know, before I ask Stabby to ask you a question, I'm just going to ask one more question myself, which is, there's so many different Dalek designs, and there's quite a few different ones in here as well that you might have noticed. But out of the whole series of all the series, all the Doctors and everything.
Yes.
What is your favorite Dalek? It could be an individual or a design. What's your favorite one?
I can tell you straight off. It's the ones that were introduced in the chase. So the silver and blue design, but with the slats down the side. That, to me, that's really... I mean, I love them all, to be quite frank. That's the one that really does it for me. That, to me, is the classic design. Mm-hmm. And obviously, Death to the Daleks. I have such a love for that much maligned story, Death to the Daleks. So I quite like those silver and black ones, too. And in fact, we did buy a silver and black replica to go into the Big Finish office. But we've moved offices now, and the offices are much smaller. And so it can't fit there. So it's gone to the warehouse.
I thought you were going to say it's gone to your house. Yeah, we have a big mixture of people. What era they like the most. Some people like the classic era. Some people like the modern era. And some people like the movie Daleks, of course, as well.
Oh, I love those too. Yeah, yeah.
They're a great design. I mean, they're a great design as well. Obviously, would you say that the new Time War sort of era Dalek is an echo of the movie design? Because some people say it is.
Well, because, Russell T. Davis said to Mike Tucker, who put the Dalek together, I want the most Dalek-y Dalek there is. And so use any elements. I think it was fun to do the big lights. I think it's a very effective. I think the piddly little lights from the first Daleks look like someone could just go along and flick them off with their fingers. Yeah.
Do not flick my lights!
I do love that. I remember when seeing that bronze Dalek for the first time and plus the whole excitement of getting that job. In case you didn't know, it was like a fantastic dream come true.
Of course.
And I'd sort of been held in suspense beforehand because my best friend Rob Shearman was writing the episode. By the way, Rob sends his love to you all. I just spoke to him about half an hour ago, before I started. He said, please give them all my love for us. I will let him know. I'll probably speak to him this week, actually, but I'm probably going to have a Zoom. Now I've completely forgotten what I was talking about. What was I talking about? Oh yes, he was writing it. And there was an element with him saying, I know you would have loved to have written it, Nick, but so I feel terrible telling you about it. I said, no, it's fine, man. I'm really happy for you. I said, obviously, it'd be lovely to do the voice. And he went, well, I've no idea what plans they've got and everything. So I was on tenterhooks for ages. And then, you may have heard me tell the story before where there was a meeting of all the licensees, but not Big Finish, funnily enough, but... And the then editor of Doctor Who magazine, Clayton Hickman, was there. And he put his hand up at the end when Russell T. Davis was giving a presentation about what was going to happen in the new Doctor Who. And he said, and the Daleks are coming back, blah, blah, blah. And Clayton put his hand up and said, if the Daleks are coming back, are you going to get Nick Briggs to do the voice? And Russell allegedly said, yes, but don't tell him yet because we haven't contacted his agent. So... immediately Clayton phoned me and said, look, don't tell anyone, and then he told me this. And then a few days later, the editor of the Doctor Who books, Justin Richards, phoned me and said, listen, don't tell anyone, but Russell T. Davis said, so I've been told by two people I was going to get the job. And then I think Rob said, apparently they're going to give you the job. And then what felt like 3,000 years came, and I'm just waiting. And finally my agent at the time of the time phoned me and he phoned me. So going back to your question, Scarlet Eyes, my agent phoned me so infrequently that whenever he phoned me, he's going, hello, Nick, it's Jim. And I go, Jim. And he goes,
that again?
Being agent, I go, oh, yeah, that Jim. Okay, I don't know any Jims apart from my father, and he never called himself Jim to me.
Who do I pay that's called Jim?
So he said, right, Nicky boy, they want you, they're going to pay you properly, employ you, as an actor, and it's going to be great. So, and I can't remember the first person I told. I only now remember the second person I told. by text. It was David Tennant, funnily enough. It wasn't even Dr. Who. Oh, wow. He texted back, "Ex bloody terminate. Together we will conquer the universe," he said. You know. And it was such a thrilling moment. So all that build up to going on set and seeing them, you know, just muddying up that bronze Dalek to make it look all, you know, bashed up. It was just, wow, some of the most exciting moments of my entire life. How sad and I am.
Can you remember tuning in when it first broadcast as well?
Yes, people wanted me to. Rob used to have people round to his house to watch Doctor Who, that first series, and he'd invited me round for it, and I said, "I can't do that. I have to be on my own to enjoy this." but then I went round to him afterwards. Yeah, and that might have been. Was it that? That might have been when Stephen Moffat was round there, and he sneakily showed us the first episode of The Empty Child, which we were very... He said, "Actually, in my bag, I've got a DVD." So, yeah, that was really lovely. No. It was a lovely time.
That's awesome. That's one of those times... That would probably... Would you class that as your biggest career moment, would you say, or when that all happened?
Have you talked since? I don't know. I'll have to think about that. But it certainly was big. And I remember also that the girlfriend I had at the time, who for her own benefit will remain nameless, she texted me and said, "You are a god," the moment the episode ended, which was just the most incredible. She was given to overstatement, of course. But it was just the most wonderful thing, you know, to realise. Because I felt like I'd worked on that episode forever, because I had more involvement post-production wise with that episode than I had with any subsequent episode, where Joe Ahern, the director, would have various edits sent to me and ask me to comment on what I thought needed replacing. You know, he left it entirely up to me.
You were really sort of involved then, not just in the voice acting side of it, but you were really involved in the steering of the edit as well.
Well, not actually the steering of the editing, but the steering of the use of which voice. You know, so when I went into the dubbing suite afterwards, the ADR studio, I was able to say to them, "These are the lines I want to replace." And there was some conversation between me and Paul, the editor, where he would say, "Nick, I really don't," because there was a point where they put a gate. Do you know what an audio gate is that cuts out on certain frequencies, you know, to cut out background noise? That we had a gate on the recording that we did on set, and the bit where the Dalek is exposed, you know, inside its casing, while I was doing that on set, the gate keeps cutting in and out. And I felt that was technically imperfect, and I wanted to replace that. But the editor very wisely said to me, he said, "Nick, I don't want to change that if you're okay with it," because he said, "It sounds like it's going wrong," and that's precisely what we want at this moment. We
that's
want
the vibe
it to sound
you get
like
when you watch
struggling.
That part. Yeah, it sounds like it's dying or, you know, injured. Yeah.
But that was just the gate overreacting. I want to blame...
Well, sometimes you get
that?
Happy coincidences.
Yeah. I want to blame Matt Baker. It's not really true, but he was on set filming that day, and he just went and had a go on my ring modulator without asking permission. He also broke the Dalek. He got in it and drove it into something and broke the sucker. The Blue Peter team were a complete pain in the neck on the set, to be quite frank. They kept tripping over wires. And I remember Matt Baker interviewing me, and every time he interviewed me, he asked the question, but the producer whispered it in his ear, and then he asked me the question, and I'd answer, and he'd sort of nod and look at me and not say anything, and there'd be this terrible pause, and then the director would say, "And then ask him about what it..." You know, it was really weird. I thought that he didn't have any interest in Doctor Who, he was just being told what to say. It was very odd.
Oh, dear. Well, you get that sometimes, I suppose. Right, I'm going to let Stabby ask a question now, because, you know...
Okay, Stabby.
You know, just one person.
Go on,
ahead, Stabby. I'm just going to check the stream.
So, obviously, I've been watching Doctor Who since I was, like, 6 years old. And I've loved the Daleks ever since I was six. My question is, have you ever experienced any challenges while recording for Doctor Who or encapsulating a character or anything at all like that? And how did you overcome it?
Well, difficult challenges, yeah. It's always a challenge. I mean, I think the strangest challenge was not Dalek-related, it was Judoon-related. And the bizarre thing that happened about that is that my agent, who I mentioned before, phoned me up and said, all right, Nicky boy, they want you to go in on Monday. This was Friday night. And I said, oh, right, what's this then? He said, oh, well, it's the Judoon captain. And I said, and you know, when someone says that to you for the first time, the Judoon captain, I went, sorry, what? The Judoon captain? I said, a captain? What captain? What? What is this? He said, well, you're the blooming Doctor Who fan. You should know. I said, I have no idea what a Judoon captain is. He said, well, I've no idea. But anyway, they want you to go on set and do the voice, all right, on Monday in Cardiff. I said, yeah, okay. He said, I don't think they'll be able to get a script to you before you get there. Oh, great. Fine. Because it was Friday, and I think they must have emailed something. I don't know. It was a long time ago. Were they emailing scripts in those days? Maybe not. So I thought, who should I ask? I thought, I know who I'll ask, who I've got the phone number of, David Tennant. So I phoned David up. I said, oh, hi, how are you? And I said, yeah, great. I said, I'm coming in on Monday. And he went, oh, great. Yeah, I'm glad about that. I said, apparently I'm playing a Judoon. Oh, good. Yeah, he said, because in the read through, every time we got to the Judoon's voice, someone just read in and the whole thing seemed to die. And they said, we've got to get someone in to do a voice on set. So we've got something to react to. And they thought, yeah, we'll get you. And I said, okay, well, I've no idea what it is. And he said, no. He said, well, it's kind of like an astronaut with a rhinoceros's head. That's why. And I went, oh, right. Okay.
That's a good description.
Yeah. So anyway, so I turned up on set. And it was the first time I'd been on the Doctor Who set when it wasn't freezing cold. Normally, my episodes are filmed in the freezing cold. So I'm wearing 5 jumpers and 3 coats. And they all said to me, my God, you've lost weight. I said, no, I'm just wearing a shirt. That's why, you know,
I'm not wearing 5 layers today.
Ironic, considering it was in space.
I went to... going to do for this thing? I said, well, I've no idea. I haven't seen it. And he said, oh, well, they're just putting the guy in the costume. Do you want to go and have a look and maybe see the face and see what you want to do? So I thought, God, we're going to film this in a minute. I've no idea what I'm going to do. So I went round to see Paul, whose surname I've forgotten. Really annoying. He used to play all the hero monsters. Absolutely brilliant guy. He was having this thing fitted on him, which I think was half killing him. And I just looked at the face and I was sort of going. I thought, yeah, it's going to speak like that. So I went back to Charlie Palmer. He said, so how's it going to speak? And I said, I thought he would speak like this. And he just went, and I went, oh, all right, maybe something else. He said, no, that's brilliant. It's hilarious. I said, oh, okay. Is that all right? Anyway, yeah, that's what I want. Brilliant. Funny. Yeah.
That's good. The first one you came up with as well. That's handy.
Exactly. Could go the other way and have this enormous hulking monster come on and go, hello, everybody, I'm a Judoon. You could go the other way. But we didn't do that. Yeah.
Oh, dear.
So, you know, it's and it was fun to do. And Charlie was a great director. And it was a great, and you know, that's, and I had already met Freema the year before on the big finale. So it was lovely to see her again. We had lots of fun. It was great. But that was a challenge. You know, I really thought if I don't come up with something, I'm just going to get fired.
I'm assuming you had fun doing the Judoon's own personal language as well, not just the human speech.
But it was all that stuff was written down, you see. And when I first read it, I thought it was all their names. You know, like in Trumpton, when they say, Jew, yes, Brew, yes. Barney McGrew, Cuthbert, Dibble, Grub. I thought it was like that. I thought he was going,
Ko, Fo, Bo, Ho, No, Fo.
You know, there were all these other Judoons.
Yeah, that's me. Yeah, I'm here.
That's what I thought. It was only halfway through the shoot, it suddenly occurred to me, oh, this is their language. This is them articulating ideas. I see. Yeah. But that was, it was all written down, and I was absolutely determined that I should follow it. I was really frightened of getting any of the words wrong. But as it turns out, you could be saying almost anything, really, couldn't you?
Yeah, I assumed it was improv.
No, not at all. No, I was absolutely sticking to the script.
Because what I was wondering about was when you had what some people would say the sort of controversial or the different designs with the Daleks. Obviously, we've got a paradigm Dalek on the very end there. So there is representation, which is good.
Yeah.
what was the thinking with the voice with those? Because you changed the voice, they changed the design, and you changed the voice as well. So what was your sort of thinking with
well,
that?
Well, I just wanted to do something that sort of thing. So I mean, it's ages since I've done it actually, because they've gone away.
The basic Dalek voice, and then I added that round there. So that just has an extra sort of, can you hear it? There's an extra bite to it. I've turned the LFO up, basically.
So they spoke like that, you know. You will be destroyed.
So it's very similar to the normal Dalek voice. It's just got a little bit more...
authority.
Fiddled the wrong note. but that really is something that...
that I came up with on set, really, fiddling around with the settings. There was a great sound man called Bryn, I remember I worked with on that one, and I've been working with him off and on for years, and we fiddled around with that. And so he learnt the different settings. So he said, listen, mate, you just do the Daleks talking to each other. I'll look at the eyes and I'll whiz the thing around I'll give you the nod when I've twiddled with your dials. I chose my words.
Somebody on the live stream is saying, bring back the paradigm Daleks for Big Finish. Is that something you consider? Is that something you'd do?
Yeah, I certainly would consider that. I mean, we did we do paradigm? No, I don't think we ever have we? No, because they've... Mm. We should do that at some point, shouldn't we? Yeah, I mean, because they're very vocally distinctive.
On the subject of paradigms, I've been thinking about something for quite a long time. I've discussed it with you a few times, Ryan. The Eternal, it's never explained what its purpose is. I have a theory about it, but...
I think it's something like it waits at a bus stop for a long time. It seems like an eternity before the bus turns up.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's a lot of different theories about different types of Daleks. There's so many out there. And just looking at the time, we've got about 2 minutes before I want to move on just to the Q&A, Nick. So yes. That means we're going to open it up to our audience, which means it'll be down to their questions. But before we do, I want to just ask you my sort of last question, which is, we talked all about the past and the present, but what's, in your mind, the future for the Daleks? What's the next thing, do you think, on the horizon for the Dalek species?
You mean in the TV series?
Yeah, potentially, in terms of where it's heading. Where would you like it to go?
I have no idea. I mean, of course, I have an idea that you don't have, because I know what happens in the festive special this year.
Ah, yeah. Well, remember last time there was the new Dalek.
Yeah. I can't. Well, it's more than my life's worth to tell you anything about that episode.
We're not going to pry into that, and we're not going to even try. So
there's some interesting developments in that story. Very, very exciting. But as to the future and the TV series, I mean, the difference between me at Big Finish is that when I'm at Big Finish, to use the analogy of a house, I'm like the architect and in charge of all the building. Whereas on the TV series, I'm like the electrician who's come in to put the plug socket in. I'm fulfilling one task, and I'm not, you know, I have no, it depends on the director. I mean, some directors, to them, they've got their minds on other things, and I'm there to do the Dalek voice, and I get introduced to them, and they're a bit sort of like, yeah, okay, fine, you're the Dalek voice, yeah, whatever. It's a bit like someone introducing them to the person who makes the tea or indeed changes the plug. They go, yeah, very nice to meet you. Yeah, fine, well, just do your thing. It's nothing to do with me, you do it. Whereas then you get a director like Rachel Talalay or Hetty MacDonald. Rachel she just immediately said to me, I'm a huge fan of your work and everything, and really is interested in what, and Hetty MacDonald would really study the Dalek lines and come dashing behind the set to me and say, the way you're the Supreme saying that at that point, what is it you're thinking? And I'd say, well, I'm thinking X, Y, Z. And she'd go, I think he's more thinking this. And you go, oh, yeah. She said, so say it for me thinking that. And then she goes, yeah, that's better, isn't it? So she was really taking notice of it. So there's a big difference.
Yeah.
But I can't, it's really rewarding. So Rachel and Hetty particularly were marvellous. But what I'm saying is, I don't get any real influence on what's going on. Well, you know, no showrunner has ever contacted me and asked me. No showrunner has ever contacted me and asked me, where should we go next for the Daleks, Nick?
If only they would. But what I'm saying is...
I get to do that with Big Finish.
Where would you like to see the Dalek story go? I mean, is there anything that you think that would like to happen with them, or any storylines you think that would be great that have not been told yet?
Well, I wouldn't like to say that because I don't want to reveal any of my ideas for future Doctor Who stories.
We've got notepads, so we're about to write them down.
But let me be a politician and answer the question I want to answer. And I think the stories that work best with Daleks are when the Daleks, I mean, it's fine to use them like this as like a faceless army of characterless creatures. But I think that the stories are much better when you have very individual Dalek characters and you hear the scheming, sinister elements of them rather than just all turning up and saying exterminate and blowing everything up. I mean, they're perfect for that. That's why they're so good in stories. If you need this kind of monstrous horde, they're great for that. But I love the stories where there's slightly more to them and the Doctor's thinking, oh my God, they've outwitted me, rather than sort of tending towards saying, yeah, they're big and stupid. They say exterminate and they blow things up. There's
I really
no
like Dalek Khan. Dalek Khan's a real character with a real interesting voice as well.
The cult of Skaro got their own personalities.
Yeah.
What I want to do now, Nick, is we're going to aim the spotlight on our audience, who are sitting very intently, very quietly. They've been very good, very well-behaved Daleks. And that one's holding the head of a Cyberman there, so that's not very good. But I'm going to ask all of you, I might regret this, but I'm going to ask all of you now to unmute your microphones.
Yay.
There you go.
The gags have been taken off.
I can breathe again.
There you go.
I can't breathe in this mask. Anyway.
If you have a question for Mr. Nicholas Briggs, if you put your plunger in the air, okay, Imperator.
I have a question for Nick Briggs. In the episode Daleks in Manhattan, when they revealed the Daleks' ultimate plan of Dalek sex ability to turn into a human, did you think that was absolutely brilliant and clever of them to do, or what were your thoughts on that?
Well, I...
diplomatic,
my main memory of that
answer...
My main memory of that is Eric Lauren, who played Mr. Diagoras. That's his name, wasn't it? Is that right? Yeah.
Yeah.
He was very concerned to get the Dalek intonation into his voice when he had the sausages hanging off the side of his face. We used to call him Mr. Sausage Man.
Oh, my God.
And so he said, can you do my lines for me? Can you come to my room and do your lines for me? And I'll record them. I said, well, I can't set up the ring modulator to work with your little dictaphone thing. But anyway, I went and I had to sit in front of Eric, who I hardly knew at that point, saying all his lines. And he was sort of mouthing them. So you notice he always says Dalek, you know, because he notices I always go Dalek. It's much better rather than going Dalek. It's much better to extend the A sound. Dalek. But also the pain for him is that he was he had all this animatronic stuff on his head, so he virtually couldn't hear anything that was being said to him. So he was just sort of looking to see when people's lips stopped moving, because all he could hear was zzz, 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 in his head.
Oh God, that's a challenge.
I thought it was a fun idea. I'll tell you one other outrageous story about that, if you like. When you're shooting Doctor Who, as I mentioned before, just by terrible coincidence, it was usually freezing cold. and you're usually in a freezing cold location. So what do you do when you're freezing cold, apart from put loads of clothes on? You drink lots of hot drinks. And then you're a man in your, I think I was still in my 40s then, but, you know, I'm in my 50s now, but whatever. But you're a man of a certain age. And when you get a little bit older, gentlemen, you know, you need to go to the toilet more often. So there I am drinking masses of hot tea and needing to have a wee, basically, not to put too fine a point on it. And so my main memory of that shoot is that lots of young girls who are all the young women, I should say, who are the often the assistant directors telling me, I can't go to the loo because we're just about to shoot a scene with you.
Oh, God.
You
know,
which means in about half an hour's time, something's going to be done. But anyway, meanwhile, Eric Lawrence says, oh, I must just go. And I can hear everyone else's mics on my headphones. And I hear Eric say, I need to go for a pee. And they go, OK. So off he goes. So I hear Eric Lawrence running along and he's still got his radio mic on. And I can hear that sort of jangling of keys in pocket. And then I hear him go into a cubicle and I hear him unzip. And have a wee. And that's bad enough in itself, okay, for all sorts of reasons. But what I'm driving at is that he is doing the very thing I want to be doing. When you need to go to the loo.
People have been coaching like that in the past. Oh dear.
I know that one of the Dalek operators. I know one of the Dalek operators asked several times to be removed from his Dalek so that he could go to the toilet, and they kept ignoring it. And he eventually said, "If you don't take the lid off, I'm going to pee down the gun." I distracted you from talking about plot by talking about going to the toilet instead.
Jonas.
Next question. Hands up in the air or plunges up in the air. Dalek Jonas.
Which
Dalek did you wish you could do more voice lines for?
Which Dalek do I wish I could do more voice lines for? It's really hard to choose, actually, because it's fun doing all the very different Daleks, you know, very strangulated sort of things like, you know, Dalek Khan, or doing big boomy ones like the Emperor. I quite like just doing the regular one, though, you know, the regular mid-range one.
Who just talks like this all the time?
Quite like that. But I'm up for more challenges, you know. I'm up for different Daleks to be created all the time.
Is that actually a question, Jonas?
Yeah. Seems like it.
Thank you. Sorry it was short.
Anyone else?
And no references to lavatories.
Hello, we avoided it this time.
Okay.
So Cyberman on the end there. Yeah.
Hello.
So how did you convince Mr. Eccleston to come back to Big Finish? Oh no, not to come back to work for Big Finish.
To do Big Finish, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it was just
big news for everybody.
Yeah, it's very exciting. I'm writing a script now for it. Well, it was just a negotiation process between his agent and mainly Jason Hay-Gellery, who's co-exec with me and chairman of Big Finish. Mm-hmm. He deals with all the business side of it. But I talked to his agent a lot on the creative front, and we talked about the kinds of stories we'd like to do. And I, you know, had some ideas, and they weren't quite so well received. So I wrote a spec script sample, and that helped. You know, he liked the direction it was going in. So yeah, that's kind of how.
So you went to him. You went to him with the rough story idea, very, very broad strokes.
We'd asked several times before. I mean, don't think that the doctors who aren't working for Big Finish don't think we don't ask regularly. you know, and it's interesting that sometimes various stories come out in the press where we hear quotes of people saying, oh, well, if they'd ask, I might do it. But, you know, whether it's cross wires or whatever, we are quite regularly asking. And, you know, on this occasion, we asked and there was a bit more interest. And so Chris had never shut the door on it. He had always said, oh, not just at the moment kind of thing. But thanks for asking.
Sure,
always,
yeah.
With the message sent back to us was always very nice. And at one point he sent a message back to me saying, oh, yeah, you know, say hi to Nick for me, because he'd remembered me from working with me on the show, which is very nice of him. But this time, yeah, we didn't have a story. We went and just asked again and they were interested. And then we talked about, oh, well, what sort of thing would we want to do? So that's when, you know, I ended up writing a spec script and getting that sent to him. And that seemed to, you know, help the process a lot. But, you know, there are always negotiations with agents that, you know.
Yeah, and of course, the way things are happening at the moment with, you know, COVID and whatnot, I'm assuming that there's a chance you might not actually physically be in the same studio then when you come to produce this.
Yeah, I think there's quite a considerable chance of that. I mean, what we're doing with a lot of actors now is that we're having them come into the studio, you know, and directing them remotely. So that, you know, done online, not quite as elaborately as this, obviously. That would be good. Little sort of avatars. But yeah.
It'd be great if you could have meetings like this.
Yeah.
That's the next thing for you, for Big Finish. You all have your own Daleks.
So, yes, any more? I may not. Yeah.
Sorry, go on. I was going to say, any more questions on the floor from anybody? Melvacor, put your hand up there.
Hello. There's a question. What is your favourite Dalek quote? Like, for example, my vision is impaired. Do you have any other favourite like that?
Yeah, my favourite thing, actually, certainly from the new series, is...
You would make a good Dalek.
It's a lovely point in the story, isn't it, where the Doctor finally lets go and really rips into the Dalek, and the Dalek just sits there and says, yeah, you're like me now, aren't you? And
that's
the Doctor's defeated by
that.
And that's interesting that that's with the same Doctor that you're going to be working with.
Indeed.
Very soon.
Indeed.
So that's good. There might be a similar moment. Who knows? That'd be fantastic. Yeah, but it's one that stands out for a lot of fans, of course, because it's a sort of pivotal scene.
Definitely.
Any more questions on the floor from anybody?
Pigeon has had his eye stalk up for a bit
sorry.
Now.
Where are you? On the left. Dalek Pigeon.
Can you be my father?
Oh my god.
Could you ask something like that?
Dalek Pigeon.
Oh boy.
We survived through him.
We've got time for one or two more questions. So just going to go to Cyberman Sean on the far left again.
Okay, so if I'm not mistaken, in An Adventure in Space and Time, you played the original
Peter
Dalek
Hawkins.
Voice actor.
Yeah, Peter Hawkins.
Whose idea was that? Was that your idea to be?
It was Mark Gatiss's idea. Yeah.
Yeah.
I can tell you the story of that. I can tell you the story of that, which is that Mark Gatiss, I mean, I've known him for years and he's a really good friend. And some time back, I ended up doing directing and doing the editing and music for a series called Nebulous on Radio 4. I don't know whether any of you ever heard that, a comedy sci-fi thing that owes a lot to Doctor Who and Quatermass. And it stars Mark Gatiss and has Steve Coogan and various people in it. Oh, and David Warner and, who's the chap who was in Horns of Nymon, you know, Lord Nymon, him. Absolutely brilliant. Graham Crowden, yeah.
Right.
But when I first got involved in that, and there is a point to this, Mark Gatiss phoned me up and said, oh, we're doing this thing called Nebulous, blah, blah, blah. I said, oh, that's very exciting. He said, and I thought he was going to ask me to be in it or something. And he said, do you know a good studio we can use? I went, oh, right. it ended up, he said they were doing it at a different studio, and he said, would you come along to the recording and give us the benefits of your experience? I thought, oh, okay. I thought he just wants me to come along and advise. So I turned up to the recording, and the producer said, let's have a read through, and everyone read through, and I think I might have been doing one little voice or something like that, and I was sitting there thinking, oh, this is all very interesting, and then they said, right, okay, shall we go into the studio now? And I went, yeah, okay. And Mark Gatiss said, well, then Briggsy, off you go. I said, what? And I went out to him and said, what do you mean? He said, well, direct the blooming thing. And I went, what? You didn't say I was directing. And he said, well, I did. I said, no, you said give us the benefit of your experience. I thought you just wanted to ask my advice about microphones or sound levels or something, you know. And he went, no. And I said, look, I said, mate, I would have maybe scheduled it or made some notes or something. But anyway, I managed to direct it and it was all fine. And we did three series of it. So what happened with the Daleks thing, with the adventure in space and time, that Mark said, would you like to come along and be on the set, you know, and just be, and I said, oh, yeah. And he said, maybe we can sort of just, you know, have you there and that'd be brilliant. So I went to the set and everything. He showed me the set and then they said, well, we're going to have you as the, you know, the guy who's doing the Dalek voice. And I said, oh, yeah, great, fine. And so they said, so they put a wig on me and everything and put me in. And I thought, this would be great. And I'll just be there and the camera will track past me. Mm. And they said, so we're going to do the first scene. Has Nick got a script? And Mark said, he doesn't need a script. He knows it off by heart. God. And I just thought, what is going on here? What is going on? And they said, we're going to do the first Dalek scene. And I said, well, I know the first line, but I don't know the whole scene, you know. And they went, oh, well, we'll give you a script. And then I put my glasses on. They said, you can't wear those because they're not in keeping with the period. I said, I can't see the script without them. and then they said, oh, and you've got your thing, haven't you? And I said, what thing? They said, your ring modulator.
Got your thing.
You didn't ask me to bring it. I didn't.
Oh, no.
I don't carry it around with me. So I had to do the Dalek voice without the ring modulator. And yes, it's
in my pocket.
Yeah. So literally, as they were doing the shot, there's a shot that sort of spins round and eventually passes me at some point. And when I'm doing the Dalek lines, and they kept giving me pairs of glasses that fitted with the period, and I'd look at them and I go, I can't see anything. Hand it back to them. They give me another. I said, this is really hurting me. And they eventually gave me a pair that I just got on just in time, just as the camera came past me and I was doing the lines. So it's a real. Yeah, I didn't realise I was going to actually be playing a part, is what I'm telling you. Yeah. Because Mark just, you know, he's so laid back and lovely and wants to give people opportunities. He didn't, if he'd said to me, I'd like you to come and play Peter Hawkins and you'll be doing the lines from the first ever Dalek scene, then I would have understood and brought my ring modulator. But he didn't say any of those things. Yeah.
Well, you got through it, though, that's the main thing.
It was great fun. So, and you know, I don't know about you, when I watched that whole production, I just tear up right at the beginning because of the sort of, it's just the nostalgia is so heavy. I remember watching it on the, when it was broadcast, I think, oh, maybe I saw it on the iPlayer, but I was at the hotel where the big 50th anniversary event was going on and I had to go and do a panel or something afterwards. And I was really embarrassed because my eyes were really red because I'd been sobbing like a baby in my hotel room because I'd been so moved by this brilliant drama.
I don't think I ever want to hear a Dalek cry.
That's what it's all about, is eliciting, you know, an emotion, isn't it? At the end of the day, that's what we're trying to achieve with good drama.
Yeah.
Well, I don't think there's any more. Right, very last question now from the Red Dalek, nearly on the end there, third from the end, active taser.
Yeah,
Don.
Hello.
I would like to ask a question to Nick Briggs. Personally, what do you think is your favorite TARDIS interior?
I really like the original from the original series, but if you're talking about the new series, I particularly liked that one, that second Matt Smith one that sort of went into the Capaldi era as well.
That's my favorite as well.
Because it sort of encapsulates all the original series stuff. And I like the fact that when you went into it, I mean, it looked from the outside, I don't know whether they've shown behind the scenes shots of it, but when you looked at it, it looked like Noah's Ark. It's this sort of complete, enormous, tall ship thing. And you go in there and you'd be completely... And it worked. When they did the dematerialization, I thought when I first saw it that all the flashing lights and the revolving stuff, I thought that was all CGI. But no, it actually did do that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, Michael Pitrod designed it. And he was brilliant. I'm very sorry he's no longer with us. He was a brilliant and lovely man. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I always love practical effects as much as possible. Yeah. I'm one of those, I think, and that's why when you said at the very beginning of the talk about how they were thinking of bringing the Daleks back and they were toying with CGI and all this, I'm so glad they went the way that they did.
Well, people get intoxicated by new technology, don't they? And I think it's David Tennant who said, the brilliant thing about working with the Daleks, he said, most of the time in Doctor Who, or often, you're working with a green background and someone with a pole and a silver ball on it going, this is a thing. And he said, with the Daleks, they turn up, the lights flash, and you hear the voice. He said, it's a complete thing, and it's great to work with that complete creation on set. Yeah. And I think that is, and there's always a real reaction from everyone when the Dalek speaks on set, and at read-throughs, when we're lucky enough to be able to have them. So, it creates a sense of occasion, I think, the in-camera effect of the Daleks, basically.
It is iconic, and obviously, you've been such a big part of making that legacy continue to be iconic. And, it's inspired so many more fans, many of which are here. A lot of the people in the audience are huge fans because of you, not necessarily because of the classic episodes. There's a huge mix. But look, I want to try and draw things to an end now because we're getting towards that time. So all I want to say really, Nick, is just, thank you so much for giving up your evening today.
Well, thank you for inviting
and for,
me.
Spending some time with us on Scaro, virtual Scaro. And of course, thank you to our live audience as well. You've been excellent, very intently listening. And
thank you.
Not butting in, stuff like that.
Very well behaved. Very well behaved.
Absolutely, absolutely. We've all had a great time with it. And also, thank you, 21, who's been watching the live stream as well. So, look, Nick, before we turn off the stream and draw things to an end, I'm just going to give you the last word, really, of the evening. I'm going to let you finish things off in the way you want to, and maybe the other Daleks as well might want to join in with you. I don't know. We'll see what happens. But the last word, Nick, what is that last word from you tonight?
The last word is always the first and last word for the Daleks. Obey me, my Daleks, and say after me, exterminate!
Exterminate!
Exterminate! Exterminate! Exterminate! Exterminate!